We can stop the rain. Welcome to Decent Life. I'm Lou Pugliafito. The number to call in is 212-245-7273. 212-245-7273. The guidelines for calling in are is to lower the volume on your TV or your computer, because if it's too loud, we'll get feedback. Also, just listen to your phone if you're calling in, because we are on an 8-second delay, which means that I'll be trying to reach you, and before you realize it, I'll be hanging up and you'll have to call back. And if you want, you can give us your first name and the location from where you're calling from. And as you see, we have a guest today. But before I get started, just want to let everybody know, thanks a lot out there. You know, it was a great day today out in the streets. I guess we're coming up to the election and everybody's more responsive. But, you know, I appreciate it. And all I ask for you is, if you agree with me, please spread the word and vote on Tuesday, please. And with us today is Frank Farance, who is a Roosevelt Island community leader. And I met him during the course of my campaigning out there. And I figured he had some interesting things, topics he wants like to talk about today. And so Frank, welcome to the show.
Welcome, thank you for having me on.
Hey, it's a pleasure. And so Frank, before we get started, can you just discuss it? I'll tell everybody a little bit about your background, how long you've been there, and so on like that.
Well, I live on Roosevelt Island. I've lived there for 38 years, in the same building for 38 years. It was originally a Mitchell Lama building, and they converted to a affordability co-op, which is fantastic. And I've been involved in a lot of things in the community. I've been former president of the Residents Association, sort of like a small community board for Roosevelt Island. I've been involved in things where there was public safety issues and abusive tactics, and we addressed that a little bit before the city did. Things you might have seen me on the news a year ago on the rat infestation on Roosevelt Island, where I exposed a 250 rat colony, which was huge. And I'm an activist in that sense, as I like to go where the truth takes me.
Right. You want to make sure that everything is transparent. Make
yes.
sure that everybody knows all the information
right.
from both sides.
Right.
And then as a community,
right.
come together and discuss, well, how are we going to resolve this? Instead of hiding things, per se.
Oh, absolutely.
And not being forthcoming.
Right.
So what brings you here today? Because I know there's a couple of things on your mind today.
Well, one of the things is that on Roosevelt Island, we have we've had a problem with water quality in the at the parks, and it's something that has really affected how we use our parks. And I should say as a sidebar, because this doesn't apply anywhere else in New York. As we're administered by Roosevelt Island Operating Corporation, RIOC, R-I-O-C, which is a state public benefit corporation that administers the island. Battery Park City is another one, but the Roosevelt Island one is sort of problematic. And they are basically our landlord and our government entity. So in a lot of ways, the services that we get aren't the services in the city many times, but the services from the state agency, and we actually pay local tax in our rents to operate this government entity.
So basically, it's a government inside the government, per
exactly,
se.
Exactly.
It's, and it's very hard to, I'm not going to put words in your mouth, but is it hard to get them to be accountable on stuff, or has it?
Yeah, so let's pretend we live somewhere else in the state of New York. Like, I grew up in Freeport on Long Island, which is a village, and it's an incorporated village, and you elect the mayor, you know, there's a board of trustees that you elect, in essence, the directors of the corporation. On Roosevelt Island, we don't have that. They're all appointees. There's seven of them, five appointed by the governor and two appointed by the mayor. And we've tried for a while to get that and make that some sort of like elective or democratic process. We've not succeeded in that. The best we're able to do is to get five out of the seven to be residents of the island, and that's a I believe a statutory requirement.
So isn't State Senator Serrano working on that, the representation? And is there a bill out there for that? At least I've seen that.
There are some bills to reformulate RIOC, but I think it's only for the purpose of taking RIOC, which was part of the, and I don't have this precisely, but the unconsolidated laws of, I think, 1983, and then move it into a section of the general statutes.
I gotcha.
I'm not an attorney, so maybe I can't express it as precisely as you would,
okay.
as a legislator would. But
oh, thank you.
But yeah, well, that's what you know. That's
I gotcha.
In a couple days, you might be doing that.
That's right.
Right. Anyway, I'm just saying that the bills that are legislators at the state level, which would be State Senator Serrano, and at present, State Assembly Member Rebecca Seawright, who's your, I guess, your opponent in the upcoming election.
Yes, very nice lady. She's very, very good.
She's a mom. I met her daughter. You know, I met her husband. You know, nice family.
Yeah, nice group.
Yep.
Yeah. You know, I hate to be running against it, but you know, we need to be a little bit tougher as we go.
Right. Well, you know? I think you know it's okay because we have elections in our own community too. I'm running for the vice president on our local residents association. So.
Oh, so is that why you're here?
No.
I'm just teasing him.
No, actually, what I'm really concerned about is just actually things that are going
the truth.
Wrong.
Yeah.
Right. Things that are going wrong, and.
So let's get to the point.
So water fountains, okay? We have water fountains and parks, not new, you know. The problem is on Roosevelt Island is that some of these water fountains have been connected to irrigation systems. So irrigation systems are the things that you see at night, you know, that they'll go out on the lawns and make sure all the lawns are watered. What they did was they tapped off of the irrigation system and then put a drinking fountain in a children's park. Actually, they've done that, I believe, in four locations, okay, in the main parks. And what's appalling about that is that those irrigation systems, the water in them is non-potable, okay, because they can be contaminated so when the stops at the end of the night and goes down, the water that's around it then flows back into it, so including things like feces. So, like if you have, you know, dogs we have a lot of geese and ducks and stuff like that, wildlife. But that goes back.
Okay, so basically, you brought in a little diagram
that I made because I did it in PowerPoint, and so if I can just walk you through it, just from the top is that. The city's water supply comes from upstate. I think many New Yorkers know that. And we have, you know, these great reservoirs just a tidbit on history. And that was one of the main reasons for the consolidation of New York back in 1898 was the consistent and good water supply on the Manhattan and Bronx side. So they come in and they go through pipes throughout the system. We've seen water mains. Okay, and then in the end they go to buildings, and that thing that you see there that says backflow preventer, that okay. has like a little arrow on it, okay? Mm-hmm. I'll explain that in a moment. And then they also go into irrigation systems. And in this case here, this one went from the irrigation system then to the water fountain, which is at the top. Now, I need to explain.
I just have one question. So the water that they're irrigating with is also goes to the water fountains as well?
It goes through. It starts at some point, it goes into the irrigation system, and they tap off of it somewhere inside the irrigation system for the water fountain.
To feed the water fountains.
Right.
Okay.
Okay. So, and I'll explain where the contamination comes, but I just want to explain this thing called a backflow preventer, because they're in actually most buildings, and what it does is... The New York City, its water supply, is intended to go to roughly about the fifth story. So think of a fifth floor walk-up in upper Manhattan where where the elevation is high. That's about as high as it's going to go. Now you have a 20-story high rise, for argument's sake, and that's in that picture there. And they use water tanks and they use pumps and stuff like that, but the water inside those pipes is four times the pressure of the water in the street. And so if that water were just to drain, to be open and connected to the street, it would actually flow back into the water main and possibly contaminate the rest of the water supply. So all buildings and many other places have these things called backflow preventers to prevent that, the water going in the wrong direction. And irrigation systems are one of them. It's been required by state law, sanitary code, since I think 1991 or 92.
All right, so now we're going to go to where we're going to discuss the contamination.
Right.
A possible, I should say, possible contamination at this point.
No. It's been tested. So I'll get to
okay,
that.
Okay. So let's see what's
been
going
verified.
On.
And so what happens with the, as I had mentioned, the sprinklers when they stop, and this is one avenue of contamination, is that the chemicals, the fertilizers, and so on, like that, go back into the water pipes, and then possibly come out, as you can see late on the top there, in the water fountains, and then also possibly can go back into the water supply elsewhere on the island.
Now this is where I get a little lost here, because doesn't the water that comes out of the irrigation and out of the water fountains go down the sewer?
Yes, okay, mostly, or into the grass, actually.
Okay.
But there are puddles around the sprinkler heads. So the way they work is when that valve turns on, which causes the sprinkler to pop up, it's shooting the water around.
Uh-huh.
And then as it starts to shut down, the head pops back down. But in that process, the water that's around it, and we've seen that around sprinkler heads, is that water can flow back in, and there's feces and contaminants.
That's why how you're saying the contamination is going on is sucking back in through the irrigation system.
That's the main reason why we don't want irrigation systems or drinking fountains connected
attached to irrigation.
And that's the main reason why it's non-potable. There's another reason in particular to these ones is that when they were doing this plumbing work, if you've seen the Three Stooges plumbing episode with, I think it's Curly, you know, in the shower.
Oh, you
know,
all the pipes all over.
Pipes,
yeah,
right.
That's a hilarious.
It was a Three Stooges operation. And they have all of this vinyl tubing under the fountains. Well, one of the things that they discovered, and apparently it's some adhesive. So when the water was tested, they had they discovered methylene chloride, which is a strong contaminant and a carcinogen. It was so high, literally, it was off the charts. It was in the notes in the water testing. It was beyond what they could actually measure. And it was 200 to 300 times the maximum of what the EPA sets in that.
So before we go to the more discussing the testing stuff, how long do you know of that the RIOC has known about this problem, or are they not transparent on that issue?
They are not transparent on that issue. They had, they've.
So about May, maybe?
No,
is the latest?
No,
they
no
longer?
No, 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 no. This goes on for years. See,
years.
The thing about having a water fountain connected to an irrigation system is that you need to shut them down in the winter, okay, and then turn them on in the spring. And when you turn off the water in the irrigation system and the drinking fountains turn off, you
all
should
right.
figure that they're connected, okay? And the reverse is true. When you turn them on in the spring and they turn on, you should figure they're connected. But even worse is that because I exposed this problem with RIOC is that there are no backflow preventers. And so that stuff is then going back into the water supply. And the ones that they had, which they're required to test annually, according to, you see the backflow preventer there.
Yeah, because now you're scaring me. Are you trying to say that contaminated water is going into the residences, or we're not sure yet?
We're not sure. That okay. part, we're not sure how far it goes back into the system, but we know that they that several of their irrigation systems had no backflow preventers, and on top of that, the ones that they did have were not tested. Now, recently there was a study that they had by a consultant, and one of the interesting things about consultants is that they offer an expert opinion, and their expert opinion on this was they went to all the other irrigation systems that are on Roosevelt Island, and it turns out every other housing property had the backflow preventer, had the tags, all, you know, less than a year. Everything was properly inspected. So it's not like no one knew about it, and it's not like this is, you know, outside the normal level of competence, you know, for anyone maintaining
the site. So what you're implying now is people knew about the issue, did not say anything, went in, fixed some backflow preventers and everything else, and not saying to the residents, oh, you know, by the way, you've been drinking water for 20 years that have been contaminated,
per se. That is almost exactly the problem that we have, which is that, so let me show you how another government agency does this, because I think your viewers will be aware
okay,
of
it. Okay, so do we have a little note here, or you just?
Well, let me just say one thing. So what we have is that we have, there was a problem with the Department of Education, a couple of, I guess about a year and a half ago, where they started testing the city's Department of Education, started testing the schools, okay, in their water quality, and they found some problems. And one of the reasons why they found problems is because their testing protocol had changed slightly. Not a problem, and it was more aggressive, and thus you'd expect to find a couple more things.
Exactly. Testing changes,
right,
so with the results.
And we had some problems on Roosevelt Island in their PSIS 217 school, which they immediately shut down the fountains, you know, did all the proper things. But what the government agency did is they said, here's what happened, here's what we discovered, here's the results. They took a proactive stance on that, and that's because, I believe, parents would not put up for that. They'd want to know exactly what health effect that, you know, this has had upon their children.
Right.
And B, okay, is that the school's chancellor, okay, and the mayor are elected, okay, and they know that any type of quashing this or, you know, turning the
right.
head, you know, and ignoring this would be completely unacceptable to the electorate, incredibly
okay.
unacceptable
I,
to the electorate.
No, I understand that you really want to explain every
yeah,
point,
sure.
but you know, we only got like a half hour show in like another 6 minutes.
Sorry, okay.
So, I know you have a lot of information on the results, the different types of chemicals that are in
sure.
there. And I think at that point we could agree yeah. that, no, not agree, but that there's something going on, and I like to go straight to the Department of Health letter
sure.
and
absolutely.
Talk about that.
Absolutely, because I think this is something where you'll see, if you've read about Newark recently and their problems that they had in their water supply, and you just say to yourself, gee, how did that happen? Keep going a couple more.
Okay.
There you go. What this letter is this is a letter from Department of Health in response to this. And the letter actually has a bunch of factual errors. There were total coliforms discovered in this, which is bacteria. There were carcinogens that were discovered in this. Factually, this is wrong. And also the one... testing that they cited was done by an unaccredited
okay.
laboratory.
So we know we have to go back. So I have to ask you why these are everything that you're saying here is wrong. Why is it in your opinion that these are wrong?
I believe it is because it's one state agency protecting another state agency, and that's something that we don't really have the ability as citizens to voice in a practical way. In terms of elections or anything like that, and it just had they done what that I'll just tell you the question we asked the state expert on this.
Okay.
We asked him at the end of his presentation, "Would you allow your children to drink in this water for years?" Okay.
Exactly.
There's a long pause. Okay, and after the pause, he said, "No." Okay.
So that answers it.
That answers it.
Just like we might over at Flint and other places that, you know, get the elected officials, they let them start drinking the water.
I think the problem is just that this is something where the State Department of Health, you know, we found this in the city too with Department of Health and the rat problem last year, is that when you have one agency investigating another agency, they go lame.
I hear that. Yeah, I understand that because, you know, it's not just in government,
right,
but also in companies as well and everything else. It's a lot of,
right,
and it's kind of hard to cut through all this political nonsense to actually do something about it. So what is it in the testing? Because I know you mentioned before something about testing, that they did the wrong criteria for the testing.
Well, a quick thing on the testing is that EPA tests require that the temperature stabilize, and which basically means you're flushing the water out until it reaches the ground temperature. And for the New York area, this is based on geology, is our groundwater temperature is about 55.
So you're saying the EPA didn't come in and test this?
No, there was two laboratories. The first one, which is unaccredited, did it incompetently. And then the second one, which is Long Island Analytical Laboratories, did it mostly fine with the exception of their finding of arsenic, you know, which has to do, there was arsenic actually in their whole testing process.
So why didn't EPA get involved?
Because what they do is because it hasn't risen to the point of an enforcement action. So at this point right now you have an entity that I believe,
okay,
you know, is tested it according to the criteria and according to the, you know, protocol.
So, but you're saying though is that if I get this right, Susan Rosenthal,
right? RIOC president.
State Senator Serrano,
right,
and Rebecca Seawright,
right,
all know about this issue.
Definitely.
Okay. And why do you feel that you're here now? Because you feel they're not doing enough.
That is true. I think one of the things, I was asked this actually as a campaign question in my own.
I got to get that plug in one more time.
Right. in my own candidacy. And I'll just get cut to the question is like, what can we spend money on? And I said, we should have a study to understand the health impact on this for our community. Carolyn Maloney, the congresswoman,
uh-huh,
did this for her district on, asthma and the power plant, Big Alice and so on like that. She seemed to be, long-term interest in this. But I think this is something really that our local people, and especially since this is a state agency, which we as residents have very little control over, I believe our state assembly member and our state senator should be exerting, you know, some pressure on RIOC to understand what the impact is. And it's clearly you have a problem with one agency sort of, I don't say whitewashing, but, you know, ignoring, turning a blind eye.
So we should basically get the EPA in to make the...
I think the EPA would do a credible job.
Okay. And I'm just curious, have you ever went out to any of the local news stations yet and say, hey, look, we have a problem here, Channel 7, Channel 5, Channel 2?
I've done that on other things, and I've gotten success with Channel 2 and WPIX, you know, on that. The problem with this one is that it's... you know, they've shut down the water fountain, so what can you say, you know, at that point? Because I think I've been involved 6 months now investigating this. And I think for your, you know, viewers, you should understand that as a citizen, when you're active in doing this, you're going to spend a lot of time. And so this point of it in terms of being newsworthy, you know, and meeting the criteria for that, I think the inspector general would be a better avenue rather than... get more action.
So has the building water been tested or just from the water fountains and the irrigations?
Our building water has been tested because it went through a co-op conversion.
Uh-huh.
The building next to us did, because they went through that process. I think they've done some sampling on the island. They have loops on the island, and they've not discovered any water quality problems in the island. So it's unclear, but everyone's very much upset about connecting fountains to irrigation systems, which is just totally wrong.
I'm just, it boggles the mind that if there's an issue, everybody needs to know about it, because a lot of times with a lot of things, they think about what's it going to cost. Let's just not talk about it and try to fix it.
That's in fact what RIOC is approaching. It's like, well, we can't really fix this. We don't really know what the plumbing is, where the plumbing is in the ground. Actually, they have a legal requirement because of the, you know, the dig 811 thing. Because they have infrastructure in the ground, they're required.
So, Frank, what would you like to see? And I guess for the other residents out there, what would you want for the final thing to be done about this? What are you asking Susan, Serrano, and Seawright? How do you get closure on this?
I want an independent entity to understand and study the health consequences to our community, and to stop this, and for Susan Rosenthal and RIOC, with the help of our state legislators, to stop this where we have to go through all of this effort to discover this.
And also, we need to also track to see what the medical records are, to see who's been sick.
Right.
And, you know, I hate to really cut you off. It's really incredible. And all I have to say is that the elected officials now and Susan Rosenthal, there is a problem there. Let's get an independent study in, and let's see where things fall.
Right.
Also see if anybody has been affected through medical records.
Yep. And thank you for bringing attention to this, because the community really needs it, and we need the visibility. Thank you for your help, sir.
It's my pleasure. You just if you want to say a couple more words while I'm queuing up my end, it would be helpful.
I'd be happy to follow up with you on this, because I think it's not just Roosevelt Island. These kinds of problems happen everywhere. And I think what citizens need to do is recognize that they need to get more involved. They're, you know, council members, state legislators, you know, not enough.
And Frank, thanks again, because with people like you and out there with love in their hearts, we can stop the rain.
Absolutely.
And all you need is love. Thanks for watching today.
Thank you, love.